The name of this video is Magnetic Dipole. Not to be confused with the magnetic dipole moment, the magnetic dipole is the equivalent of the electric or electrostatic dipole which we have seen for the electric field. I remind you that in the case of the electric field, an electric dipole is given by the following configuration: two point-like charges in space, a minus Q and a plus Q at a distance d from each other. This is my dipole, which of course has a dipole moment, okay? We call it P, as always. That's in the electric case. What is the equivalent in the magnetic case? Clearly, we're not dealing with charges, we are dealing with currents. So the idea qualitatively is to find a little loop of current which eventually mimics a dipole. And so let's see what that means. And why a little loop of current is so important in physics? Well, think about this, magnetic materials. So you have an atom with electrons, for example, a hydrogen atom, there is an electron which goes around. Of course, in a very simplistic fashion, this would be the Bohr-Rutherford model, where it's like a planetary model, okay? It's not accurate, but it gives good results, and it's not as accurate as a full quantum mechanical behavior, description. But the interesting thing is that I have an electron, which is a charge moving around. What is that? That's nothing but a loop of current, a very tiny loop of current, which generates a little magnetic field. So all magnetic materials can be explained in this fashion. So little loops of currents are actually very important, and little loop of currents are what we call the magnetic dipole, equivalent of two small charges. So the two small charges are useful in dielectric materials. The little loop of current is useful for magnetic materials. Great. So with that introduction, let us consider, first of all, a generic filiform wire. So we consider a filiform wire. This means that it's characterized by cross-sectional area dA. And it goes around a loop, a closed loop gamma. So for example, something like this. So this is my central axis gamma of the filiform wire. And the wire carries a steady current I in this direction, positive, which as always is a steady current, which is a good approximation even in the Bohr magneton, which we are going to discuss before introducing when introducing magnetic materials. As I already said, the cross-sectional area is dA. The overall area of this loop, now suppose that this loop resides exactly on the plane of the board, okay, and it has an area AL for loop, is the overall area of this loop. All right, so let us consider an origin here, O, which we need in order to compute the dipole moment, the magnetic dipole moment. And so in this case, let's consider, for example, a segment here. So this one will be a segment of length dl, infinitesimal, okay? And so this approximately triangle here is the one we're going to consider in detail. This quantity is r prime, and why is r prime? Because it's the distance between the origin I chosen, which I could do somewhere else, and this point here, where the tangent vector is t. In this fashion, this is my dl, okay. So given all that, what is the normal unit vector according to the right-hand rule associated with this circuit? Of course, it has to go into the board, so it is like that. This is my n into the board. Great. So now that we have all that, let me zoom in this triangle here. So I want to zoom in into that triangle and magnify it down here so that suppose that this one is our origin O. So then let me sketch something like this. Then let me sketch something like normal to this. Let me do it here. So this angle is 90 degrees. These are normal to each other. Okay, so then let us consider this distance here. like that. Then this is my R prime. This is my R prime. Okay, as here. And then at the same distance up here, okay, so this one is R prime. This is my triangle of interest. Let's continue this line further so that this distance is this distance here. This is again my R prime. I just repeat it for a reason which will become apparent soon. This angle here, I call it beta. This angle here, I call it alpha. This distance is a height, h, which is r prime times the sine of clearly beta. It's the height, okay? This is r prime sine beta gives me this, because these are 90 degrees orthogonal to each other. This quantity here is dl half, is half of the story. Similar, the quantity down here is also dl half. I'm not gonna write that. Alpha plus beta is obviously equal to pi. Alpha plus beta is pi. And this triangle, we said that it is characterized by an area, dA triangle, all right? Which eventually we want to compute. Okay, so with that in mind, how do we proceed in order to find what is the dipole moment associated with this? So I want the magnetic dipole moment associated with this generic structure, okay? So I remind you that by definition, the magnetic dipole moment M is given by the 1/2 volume integral in the region capital omega, where everything is defined in a bulk case, this is the most generic case, of R prime crossed J of R prime, the weighted average, in the R prime cube. Okay, great. So since we know that, now, what happens if I'm considering a Philippon wire? Well, as always, we need to remind ourselves that in this case, in the case of a Philippon wire, we have that J is actually equal to J times T. Dr prime cube, which is dv, is equal dA times dl, like this dl here, this dA. In addition, steady conditions, J dA is the flux that gives me I. So I remind you that in the bulk case, typically this we call it dI. Since we only have one single spaghetto, we just call it I, is the overall current, okay? Because we don't need to sum it up to get a bulk wire. In the bulk wire, we would call it dI. All right, so now with that in mind, two of these integrals here, we get them out with dA, and so in the last one, it has to be a circulation along gamma, all right, because it's a closed loop as always. So this M can be eventually rewritten as 1/2, the integral of dA of JA dA, of course, gives me I, okay, so that's the current I, which is constant, so I can take it outside the sine of integral. Circulation along the closed loop gamma, R prime remains as such. Cross, however, the only thing which remains of J is its direction, which is T, as we know from here. And of the volume, only dL is left. Okay, so now what is R prime vector T? And the reason why I sketch it in this way, I repeat R prime outside here, because T is nothing but this vector here. This is the zoom of this area, so I'm just zooming in. So R prime vector T, I need to fold it over in this direction, right-hand rule, and so I obtain a direction which goes into the board exactly as N. So the direction is N, and the cross product, of course, gives it the sine of the angle in between, which is alpha. So this can be rewritten as 1/2 I line integral on closed loop gamma. R prime magnitude remains, of course, sine of the angle in between R prime and T, which is alpha. T is gone, but it gives us a direction, which is ndl. Now, what is the area dAt of this triangle? Well, the area of the triangle, dAt, is given by 1/2 the base, which is dl, times the height, which is r', sine of beta. However, here we have a sine of alpha, but alpha plus beta is pi, so the sine of alpha actually is equivalent to the sine of beta because of this expression here. All right, so given that, we can further rewrite m as I, line integral on gamma of 1/2, which I bring it in, r' sine of beta dl, which is the base, times the direction n. Base times height times 1/2, this is nothing but I, the line integral on gamma of dAt. Note that dAt, even though it seems like an area, actually it goes as dl. And that's why it's still okay to do the integral on gamma, even though I call it dAt. And the direction is n. So the direction we need to keep it, 1/2 dl r' sine beta, so this actually would have been better to bring it here, so you can clearly more see that it's exactly that, is nothing but the area dAt, which again goes as dl, so the line integral is still a line integral. I remains outside, and the final result is, well, now we need to integrate all these triangles, so I keep integrating here, and I obtain another wedge, and another wedge, and another wedge, and I sum them up, all of them, eventually I obtain exactly AL. So the final result is I times AL times N. So M is given by this quantity here. As it turns out, in this case, typically this quantity we call it mu. It's just a definition. So for this kind of construction, we call it mu, the dipole moment, mu. But it's nothing but M, okay? Just definitions. All right, so with that in mind, so this is exactly the same idea behind an electrostatic dipole or electric dipole. In that case, we had the charge times the distance, and the distance goes from the negative to the positive charge. So here we have n, which is normal to the plane of the loop, which has a certain area. So instead of the distance, we have an area, and instead of a charge, we have a current. So it's the equivalent of an electric dipole. Now, to make it ideal or quasi-ideal, we need to proceed, as always, in physics, following this recipe. So first step, we want the product I times AL to be at all times constant. At the same time, I want to bring AL to 0+, which effectively means that all the r' go to 0+. So this is the same thing we've done for the electric dipole. We brought the distance to be extremely small. So this is the geometrical part, the source, which in that case was the charge, now is the current. The current, we want to bring it at the same time to plus infinite, to make it larger and larger and larger, so that the product eventually remains constant. Of course, if I only do one of them, then it's either zero or infinite. Okay, and so this is the definition of ideal or quasi-ideal, if these are not exactly the limit, but they are just small and large, which is the case in magnetic materials, then it's called quasi-ideal magnetic dipole with dipole moment mu. And so these are very important in the case of magnetic materials. Let me conclude this discussion to say that if you have, for example, mu, or in general, an m, which we know how to compute, how do we get, so this is a little parenthesis, which I think is worth doing. It's a little bit complicated to do mathematically, so I will not show it here. But what I wanted to say is that if somebody gives you at an observation point r given by mu naught over 4 pi, m cross r divided by r cube. Note that in the case of this actually it's approximate. In the case of an ideal dipole, this would be equal, and you just change mu with the m, because the same idea as we've done for the electric dipole. But if somebody gives you that, how do you get the B field? Okay, the final thing you always want to find the B field at r. Well, we know that this is equal to the curl of A. So you just need to compute the curl of A, just. It's not, unfortunately, easy. And so lots of math, which I will not do here. And you will get, however, something which is very similar, resembles the result we had for the electric field. And so it's going to be very similar, actually. 3 times m dot r, direction given by m, divided by r to the power of 5, and of course the direction is not m, but is r. Sorry about that. Clearly the direction is r, not m, r divided by 5, minus m divided by r cubed. So it's exactly the same result we had for the electric field. However, now we substitute P with M, okay? And this is a dot product here. This is the radial direction, and this is the M direction, okay? So it's fairly complicated to prove it, actually, so I will not do it here. Whereas in the electric case, it was rather simple because we didn't have to deal with these vector products and curls. And here is much more complicated to do it, so I will not do it here. So to summarize this video, magnetic dipole, not to get confused with the magnetic dipole moment. The magnetic dipole moment is for any structure you want, okay? It's defined by this quantity here, this integral. This you can do it for whatever you want. Now, if in particular, the whatever you want happens to be a filiform wire, as such, on the plane of the board like this one here, then this special magnetic dipole moment is associated with the structure which people call the magnetic dipole, which eventually, when we shrink it down to be very small in this ideal or quasi-ideal case, is a little loop of current, which is going to be useful when describing magnetic materials. So this is a special case, magnetic dipole moment, and eventually we found that it's given by the current that this loop carries times the area of that loop. The direction n is normal to the loop, and this we call it mu, but it's an m, of course. Quasi and ideal scenarios, we discuss them here, and eventually you can also find out the magnetic field in general, but I will not go into the details of that. So with this, we complete the story about magnetic dipoles and magnetic dipole moments. And eventually, we're going to still study the vector potential and magnetic dipoles to find some forces and torques in the next video. That's it.